Hello, everyone, and welcome to the first of our HitFest at Home presentations for 2024. Thank you for joining us. My name is Alison Strauss, and I'm the director of the Hippodrome Silent Film Festival and the programmer of the Hippodrome Year Round. We're just going to start off with a bit of housekeeping before we get properly underway. You should know that subtitles are available by clicking the CC icon in the YouTube video player. And if you're joining this presentation for the online premiere, you can submit questions or comments in the chat box. And our speaker, Pamela, has kindly agreed to watch along as this talk goes live. And so we'll endeavour to respond to any messages in the chat throughout the presentation. So keep an eye on the comments. And that is all the practicalities out of the way. So this is exciting. It's lovely to be back in the virtual realm with you all. As you probably know, our annual HitFest activity is concentrated over 5 days in March, but as we've grown, we've been able to stretch ourselves out luxuriously over the whole year with an autumn mini-season of silence, with touring of our own commissions to venues across Scotland and beyond, and with this series of HitFest at Home presentations. We've got one presentation scheduled each month from now until the festival kicks off, each designed to complement the programme and spark your enthusiasm for what's to come. And I'm absolutely thrilled that we're starting things off in fine style with an illustrated talk by freelance critic, curator and film historian Pamela Hutchinson, who will introduce us to the extraordinary life and work of Frances Marion. I'm delighted to say to you that this presentation will feature piano accompaniment by the wonderfully talented musician and HitFest regular Mike Nolan, who will provide accompaniment for the clips that Pamela has selected. Now, it gives me great pleasure to hand over to our presenter and main attraction, Pamela Hutchinson.
Hello, Alison, and thank you very much for that introduction. And hello to everybody listening at home. I'm just going to share my screen now. Great. So this lecture is called Frances Marion, Hollywood's Favourite Storyteller, and I hope you're going to enjoy finding out a little bit more about this wonderful woman. First of all, I'd like to say that this lecture is dedicated to the memory of Carrie Beecham, who was a fantastic film historian, a very good friend, and she's the author of the wonderful book, The Definitive Biography of Frances Marion, Without Lying Down. Carrie Beecham found out an awful lot about Frances Marion, and we wouldn't know half so much that we know about early Hollywood without her work. So I'd like to acknowledge that that she did so much work for Frances Marion and for early Hollywood research, and that we did lose sight of that last year. Moving on to the subject of today's lecture, who was Frances Marion? She was one of Hollywood's most acclaimed and successful screenwriters in the early years of the studio system. She was also a film director, an author, a journalist, a painter and sculptor. She spoke several languages and she played the piano. And if you read anything about her and what people said about her at the time, you'll also remember that she was renowned as a particularly great beauty. We think she was responsible for about 325 screenplays, and she was hailed as the all-time best script and story writer the motion picture world has ever produced. She won 2 Oscars. One of these was the equivalent of the Best Adapted Screenplay Oscar for The Big House in 1930, and the other was the equivalent of the Best Original Screenplay Oscar, which she won in 1931 for The Champ. And this particular award was not won by a solo woman until Callie Curry wrote Thelma and Louise in 1991. She wrote such hits as Stella Dallas, both silent and sound version, Dinner at 8, The Son of the Sheikh, The Wind, The Scarlet Letter, Anna Christie, and Min and Bill. Her career spanned the silent era and into the talkies, and she created roles for some of Hollywood's biggest stars, especially Mary Pickford, but also Marie Dressler, Lillian Gish, Marion Davis, Norma Shearer, the Talmadge sisters, Marlene Dietrich, Greta Garbo, Jean Harlow, Rudolph Valentino, and Wallace Beery. Marion had a particular genius for capturing the foibles of human nature and the absurdity of social hypocrisy. Her films are often notably female-led, and they offer strong, complex roles for actresses. They're filled with really powerful emotions, and they explore the possibilities of passionate love, and she had a particular interest in the nuances of the parent-child bond, often depicting unusual or adoptive families on screen. And her films are frequently very funny, although not perhaps as funny as she was when she was off duty. For example, she described the Oscar statuette as a perfect symbol of the picture business, a powerful athletic body clutching a gleaming sword, but with half of his head, the part which held his brains, completely sliced off. Our heroine was born Marion Benson Owens in San Francisco on 18th of November, 1888. Her parents divorced when she was about 10 years old, and she was sent to a Christian boarding school, which really only served to emphasize the fact that she did not like organized religion, and she was born to be something of a rebel. Her mother encouraged her artistic talents, which were many, and she sent her to the Mark Hopkins Art Institute in San Francisco when she was a teenager. And she led a relatively liberated life as a young woman. She began selling stories, poems, and artwork to magazines, as well as living it up in the bohemian parts of the city as a teenager. She fell in love with her art teacher, Wesley DeLapp, to whom she became engaged very quickly. They were actually on a date together when the earthquake hit San Francisco in April 1906, and they were married later that year. They divorced 4 years later, though. She worked as a photographer's assistant, a commercial artist, a reporter, and a poster artist, and she made a lot of interesting friends in San Francisco with a young woman. The pictured here, you'll see Jack London, the novelist, who advised her as a shy teenager in a quote that's quite floral but very interesting. If you expect to write stories pulsing with real life or put upon canvas compositions that are divinely human, you must go forth and live. Study human nature by rubbing elbows with the people, go out and work with them, eat with them, dream with them. Well, Frances Marion would be very shy for her whole life, but she took this advice very seriously, and she took a series of short-term jobs purely to get material for short stories, working shifts in a fruit cannery or as a telephone operator, overhearing all those stories. And she did live quite a lot because she was married twice before she entered her early 20s. Her second husband, Robert Pike, promised her the future of her dreams in New York and Paris, but in 1912, they moved to Los Angeles instead, where he had a job. However, soon, Marion was making interesting friends in Los Angeles. One of the first people she met up with was the comic star Marie Dressler, whom she had previously drawn for the San Francisco Chronicle. And Dressler took her under her wing and introduced Marion to the movie business. The movie business, Dressler said, was like sitting in the middle of a cement mixer. And this became one of the defining friendships of Marion's career and her life, a close friendship and a professional relationship that lasted until Dressler died in 1934. Each woman, despite the age gap, felt like something of a mother to the other. And Marion wrote some of the best roles of Dressler's life later in her career, including the dockside landlady who cares so deeply for her adopted daughter in 1930s Min and Bill. The role that won Dressler her Best Actress Oscar, and one of my favourites, the wonderful theatre dame Carlotta in the society comedy Dinner at Eight from 1933. Spending time in Dressler's social circle and being introduced to the movie world, Marion also met such illustrious people as Mary Pickford and the writer Adela Rogers St. John's, another long-term friendship. It was Adela Rogers St. John's who introduced Marion to a woman called Lois Weber, also pictured on this slide. Lois Weber was looking for a refined type starlet, and Marion was looking for a way into the movie business. So in 1914, Frances Marion was hired by Lois Weber Productions as an actress and as a writing assistant. This was a great opportunity for Marion to be part of the film world and also to be part of a film world in a female-led environment. Lois Weber was one of the most high-profile female film directors of the silent era. And Lois Weber had a huge impact on Frances Marion's career. Not least, she invented her name. She gave her the name Frances Marion for her acting work. But Marion really preferred life on what she called the dark side of the camera. As well as acting for Weber, she shifted scenery, she wrote press releases, and she cut film. This experience was really her equivalent of film school. It's here that she fell in love with the cinema, and it's here that she knew that she learned for real that she wanted to become a screenwriter. When Lois Weber moved to work for Universal, Marion did not join her. And that's really quite interesting because when Lois Weber went to Universal, that was a place where there were quite a lot of female film directors, and that would have been an interesting place for Marion to cut her teeth. Instead, Marion was destined to forge her career in a different kind of silent Hollywood, one in which the only area in which women really reigned supreme was in the screenwriting department. And of course, she was going to become one of the most successful women in that field. Also, it didn't matter about not moving to Universal with Lois Weber because someone else was about to offer her a very interesting job. So Mary Pickford, who had already become a friend, offered Marion the chance to come and work with her in 1914 at Famous Players Lasky. And here, Frances Marion worked on screenplays, on scenarios rather, for Pickford and her team, and starred alongside her in films such as A Girl of Yesterday, where Marion plays the vamp. Marion and Pickford had lots in common. It was the beginning of a beautiful friendship. They shared a sense of energy and fun, this energy and this kind of anarchic joy that audiences would find so attractive. If Pickford's fans were predisposed to like her in little girl roles, then Marion and Pickford together combined to make roles for Marion, for Pickford, that were not just little girls, but were naughty, irreverent, spirited little girls. Now, the first full screenplay that Marion wrote for Pickford was a film called The Foundling. And when she sold this screenplay to Adolf Zukor for $125, she said, "I ceased walking on this earth. It was so important to her." The film was made and one magazine got a chance to see it ahead of release and published a rave review. But something terrible happened. When Marion arrived in New York very excited for the premiere, the New York City premiere of her first film, which she felt sure was going to land her the writing contract of her dreams, she was told that the negative of the film had been destroyed in a lab fire and there was no possible chance of releasing the film at all. This was devastating. Pickford went back to Los Angeles, but Marion stayed in New York, still thinking that she could make it big as a screenwriter out there. She went to work for an organization called World Films. Quite tellingly, they had a film that was a bit of a flop. It turned out not very well at all. And Marion re-edited it and rewrote the titles and made it into a hit comedy. And so she stayed there for quite a while. But Mary Pickford didn't forget about her. In 1917, young Pickford had negotiated a brand new contract with Adolf Zukor, one which granted her complete creative control over the films that she appeared in. And she wanted these films, the films that had her name on the marquee, on the poster, to be the best films possible. So after signing the papers, Mary Pickford called Marion, her favourite screenwriter, and Marshall Nealon, a director that she really enjoyed working with, into a meeting. "I will be good," she told them. "I will make good pictures." And to that end, she hired Marion as her official scenario writer at $50,000 a year, making her one of the highest paid screenwriters in Hollywood. Pickford didn't just want to make high quality films, she wanted to make films that appeal to women. This, she felt, was the secret of her success. And so they made some films. Films such as Rebecca of Sunnybrook Farm, you'll see here in the main image, Stella Maris, and The Poor Little Rich Girl. These films were phenomenally successful and they happily defined Pickford's screen persona as the girl with the curls. What was so great about the girl with the curls? She was the young tomboyish girl from the wrong side of the tracks, the underdog who makes good. And she was portrayed by the woman who was renowned as a great beauty and the greatest female star in Hollywood. A really interesting example of how they negotiated this tension is the film Stella Maris, in which Mary Pickford plays two roles. It was based on a popular novel, one that Frances Marion had read out loud to Mary Pickford in the evening. Mary Pickford had spent most of her youth working rather than going to school, so having novels read out to her was one of her favourite ways to read. And she really liked the story of Stella Maris, but she liked it so much that she wanted to play both the lead characters. So I'm going to show you a clip from this film to show what I mean. This film was directed by Marshall Nealon in 1918, and Mary Pickford plays both the title character, Stella, who is a rich young invalid who's been almost excessively cosseted from the stresses and strains, the harsh realities of real world. And she also plays Unity Blake, an orphan who's grown up in an orphanage. She's been abused by a foster parent at this point. She's had a very, very hard life indeed. And in the clip that we're about to see, Mary Pickford will act with herself, thanks to double exposures. And Unity Blake has gone to work for the man that Stella Maris is in love with. I'm going to play the clip now, and we're going to enjoy the accompaniment by Mike Nolan. Thank you, Mike, for that. Really beautifully performed by Mary Pickford, making both characters so, so different. And interesting how Marion sort of drip feeds the information that we need to know to create the most emotional impact at the end of the snippet there. So this relationship, this friendship with Mary Pickford would really, really define both women's careers. And it's very famous. They were friends for a long, long time. They were going to stay close for their whole lives. And they comforted each other through many romantic and career woes, as well as working together as a formidable team, creating the Mary Pickford brand. If you know anything about Mary Pickford's romantic life, you'll know that Frances Marion helped her to conduct her romance with Douglas Fairbanks and also to negotiate the trickiest part of her young career, which was her divorce from her first husband and her remarriage to Douglas Fairbanks. And in fact, it was Marion who wrote Pickford's final film role, Secrets, in 1933, a film that Mary Pickford really wanted to make, even though Marion had written it for another actress. She'd written it for one of the Talmadges and wasn't sure it was quite right for Pickford, but she did her best with it. This was at a time when Shirley Temple was remaking a lot of Mary Pickford's early films. Now, Marion was very shy and wanted to spend most of her time at home, but she had really, really good friends in the business. When she formed a friendship, it was very strong. And she credited many of her successes, and there were several of them, to the network of female friends that she found in Hollywood, saying that she'd only found support and friendship from her female peers. She was undoubtedly what we would now call a feminist, and she marched and campaigned for women's suffrage. In fact, she considered it an obvious right, one that it was insulting to have to ask for. And she really liked to make this point about how women had helped her in an industry that was considered to be entirely male-dominated. She said, "Contrary to the assertion that women do all in their power to hinder one another's progress, I have found that it had always been one of my own sex who has given me a helping hand when I needed it." And of course, with the roles that she wrote for these stars, she was often the person providing that helping hand itself. She said, "Women progress more with civilization than men and reach out to each other like plants to the sun, but men at work get swept into the vortex." And later in her career, she saw how men could sometimes not be quite so helpful to her in her career. Now, after making Stella Maris in 1918, Marion did something that surprised everyone, and she went to Europe to work as a war correspondent, reporting on the contribution that women were making to the Great War, and Pickford entirely supported her in this decision. But when Marion returned from Europe in 1919, she was offered a job by the mogul William Randolph Hearst at $2,000 a week to write scenarios for his Cosmopolitan productions, which were based in New York. And this began another one of those key working relationships that would define and protect Marion's career. In fact, Marion wrote some films for her lover, Marion Davis. But it was a film she made at this point in her life that was her big breakthrough, her adaptation of Fanny Hearst's story, Humoresque, in 1920. Now, Marion had, no surprise to you, become good friends with Fanny Hearst and became passionate about adapting this particular story about a Jewish mother's sacrifice for her violinist son set in New York's Lower East Side. Now, William Randolph Hearst really didn't consider this a suitable subject for a movie, so he took some persuading. And when he did agree to the film, he insisted on a happy ending. The film was fortuitously directed by Frank Borzage, who Marion would work with several times more, and he was a great director of melodrama and knew exactly how to manipulate sentiment. This film was hugely popular and successful, and it won the first Photoplay Medal of Honor, which is a slightly forgotten award now, but it felt as important at the time as the Oscars do now. If you don't know this film, you may know the remake made in 1946 starring Joan Crawford. Now, Fanny Hearst, the writer, was originally horrified by the change of ending, but Marion, who was quite pragmatic about these things, persuaded her that this was the best thing for a cinema adaptation and that happy endings were what audiences wanted and that what studios would always insist on. Hearst eventually saw Marion's side and actually encouraged Marion to adapt more of her stories for the big screen. And in fact, it was a Fanny Hearst short story that would become the basis for one of the two films that Frances Marion actually directed in 1921, just around the corner here in the sort of landscape picture. This film, which has recently been restored, tells a short story that really tugs on the heartstrings, set in one of the poorer districts of the big city during a snowy winter. Ill mother wants to see her daughter settled in life with a good prospective husband before she dies, but her daughter's boyfriend is a cad, refuses to come home to meet the family. It becomes quite a heartbreaking scenario, and it's really telling that Frances Marion can take such a small incident and give it such weight. The film combines humour, sentiment, and a little social commentary, and there was nearly a real disaster on set when the actor who was hired to play the film's hero, the so-called real man, didn't turn up to perform one day. Marion was able to call on the perfect replacement at home. In 1919, Marion had married her third husband and the biggest love of their lives, Fred Thompson, a US Army chaplain. Now, Frances and Fred would go on to have two sons, one of whom was adopted. He stepped in to play the real man in Just Around the Corner and impressed everybody on set, which set him up for his future career in cinema. He became a cowboy star in silent movies. The same year, Frances Marion also directed a much more ambitious story, the Italian war epic, The Love Light, starring Mary Pickford in one of her few adult roles at the time. As you can see here, she plays a mother. And 2 years later, she directed the film The Song of Love, starring Norma Talmadge. But directing really wasn't for Marion, but these films work very well. She wasn't one for giving orders on set. There are many anecdotal stories about the silent film crews not being particularly respectful to female directors, but I couldn't possibly comment on whether that kind of thing continues. She preferred the role that she had carved out for herself as a writer, and she did that role. She performed that role exceptionally well. So the 1920s really were Marion's heyday as a screenwriter. And the way that she worked wasn't the way that we think of screenwriters working now. She really liked to write at home. And one of the things she felt that writing was a perfect job for women was because women wanted to be at home or needed to be at home for various reasons. So it could be done anywhere. But her idea of the screenwriter's role was much more extensive than what we might think of today. There are jokes these days about screenwriters being banished from the set. And that's certainly not how Frances Marion saw her role. She described it, in fact, to Moving Picture World in 1919. And this is what she said her job entailed. Stories, working scenarios ready for the director to proceed, tarrying with him through every scene as it is filmed, editing and cutting the complete product, and title writing every bit of it. This kind of control is basically a producer's control, and it far exceeds what most screenwriters might be expected to have in terms of involvement today. And of course, what this resulted in is pictures of exceptional quality that really had that Frances Marion touch. I think her best remembered silent films will always be these astonishingly female-led melodramas that she made in the 20s, such as Stella Dallas in 1925 for United Artists, and Lillian Gish's best two films at MGM, The Scarlet Letter in 1926 and The Wind in 1928. With these films, Marion really refined her ability to translate a novel into a collection of strong images with a swift pace and a heartbreaking finale very often. Think of Stella Dallas standing outside her daughter's wedding in the rain, Gish and Hansen on the scaffold at the climax of The Scarlet Letter, his chest branded with an A-shaped scar, or again, the same couple in an open door at the close of The Wind. Now, in an article for Photoplay in 1926, the year that The Scarlet Letter was released, Marion described the process of adapting great novels for female stars with what we might assume is a touch of self-deprecation or at least a little bit of tongue-in-cheek humour. This is how she described the process. We tear it down, we reconstruct it, we make the woman dominate, and the male character as passive as every woman would like to have her husband. We end up with a splendid vehicle for a woman star and a cyclone-wrecked story. She may be being a little sarcastic there, but it's true that stars sold pictures and stars wanted great roles, and Frances Marion was great at working with stars to find the kind of parts that they wanted. The Scarlet Letter here is an ingenious reworking of Nathaniel Hawthorne's novel. She translates it from a novel into the medium of silent cinema. She foregrounds Gish's sensitive portrayal of Hester Prynne. If you know the novel, it's sort of passionate adulteress Hester Prynne. Having her played by the sort of sensitive and soulful Gish already slightly adapts that character. And she also found ways to soothe the sensibilities of the Hayes office, who were slightly alarmed at the adulterous content of the novel. I'm going to show my second and final clip in the presentation, and this is a clip from very early on in The Scarlet Letter. This is the clip that introduces Gish as Hester Prynne, and it really shows what skill Frances Marion had with character building. A few choice details, a little light symbolism, perhaps a bit of foreshadowing, and Gish's wonderful performance here really convey the essence of Hester Prynne's character without the need for pages of explanatory intertitles. And once again, we're very lucky to have Mike Nolan accompanying.
Thank you.
in a silent film, a bonnet is not just a bonnet. I was thinking watching that, that I can't think of any other great characters from literature who have been embodied by both Lillian Gish and Demi Moore. Not so well, anyway. I'm a big fan of the novel, but I find that the adaptation directed by Victor Sjöström is a complete joy from start to finish. Here's Lillian Gish again. After The Scarlet Letter, Marion signed a contract with MGM at $3,000 a week, and more importantly, with all the caveats in place that she wanted, she was to be allowed to work from home, to write from home, where she was best and happiest, and to also she was to be given the permission to supervise her productions through to completion. Her very first assignment at MGM was an adaptation of Dorothy Scarborough's wonderful novel, The Wind, which Marion was hugely excited about, and the star, Lillian Gish, was very, very passionate about making as well. This was another great role for Gish, and it's a very dark story, has some very dangerous moments, as you can tell from the still. But The Wind, too, had to be given a softer ending than the one in the source novel. Marion fought Irving Thalberg on this point, but sort of despite her better instincts, she then wrote something completely perfect. Nevertheless, even someone as practical as Marion was bruised by this process, saying that it was the last film to which she gave her heart as well as her head. And very sadly for Marion, shortly after the film was released, the love of her life, Thompson, died on Christmas Day, 1928. He had actually contracted tetanus from an injury he sustained when he was in the stables. Now, she would be married once more, briefly, to her friend and colleague, George Hill, the director of films, including The Big House. That marriage lasted about a year. Having attempted four marriages and lost the man she loved the most, Marion was, if not cynical about men, disappointed by them and by her experience of marriage. A woman who looked like Marion had many suitors in Hollywood, but she was dismayed by the options. The title of Beecham's biography, Without Lying Down, refers to her line about the fact that she spent her life looking for a man to whom she could look up without lying down. Big changes were afoot in Hollywood, of course, and Marion did not seem fazed by the coming of sound, not at least compared to the more serious upheavals in her private life. She started the 1930s very strong with those two consecutive Oscars, and she wrote Greta Garbo's first talkie, of course, Anna Christie, including that memorably dry first line about whiskey and ginger ale, taken straight from the play. And naturally, she also lobbied for her good friend Marie Dressler to have a key role in what was going to be a very much anticipated film. This was the film that was marketed with the line, Garbo Talks. Now, for a progressive like Marion, the pre-code era offered an opportunity for films like Anna Christie that were rather frank about the relations between men and women, but also for more reforming dramas too. And she was very keen to make Big House. She researched her screenplay for this Oscar-winning hit about the need for prison reform by touring San Quentin, as many male filmmakers had done before her, but she was the first woman to ask for such a tour. And this is very much the kind of elbow rubbing that Jack London encouraged her to do so. The actual visit to the prison was a pretty unpleasant experience, not least because the warden patronized her by saying, "I'll be curious how a little woman like you handles this situation," and offering to show her an execution. But Marion considered it worthwhile. She took her work very seriously. And just another underrated film, I think, of Marion's in the sound era, which reminds me of this period of her life, is Riff Raff from 1936, in which Jean Harlow plays a cannery worker falling for Spencer Tracy's tuna fisherman in the midst of union wrangles. No doubt she remembered her teenage days as a fruit panner while writing that one. And also, I think it does portray something of her slightly left-leaning politics. I am also personally trying to tell people how wonderful Stella Dallas works as both a silent and sound film, and particularly because Frances Marion's screenplay translates so well. She wrote the screenplay for both films. Now, you will have seen, no doubt, Stella Dallas, the silent version at HipFest in previous years, and her script for this film was so tight, so full of killer images, it was hardly changed for the Barbara Stanwyck remake in 1937, including that memorable final scene of Stella watching her daughter through the window, as if it were a picture on a movie screen, silent or sound, it hardly seemed to make a difference. And yes, of course, Frances Marion was very strongly associated with the silent era. And memories of the silent era and the powerful women who worked at that time, the so-called manless Eden of the continuity department, seemed to embarrass Hollywood that had reinvented itself as a new male-led organization for the sound era. And so Marion too, eventually, slowly, discreetly fell from favor. Instead of working happily alongside their male colleagues, there was a tendency for male screenwriters to whisper about the tyranny of the woman writer. Marion's screenplays were increasingly co-credited to colleagues who worked on the dialogue, and this was somehow seen as a disparagement of her talents for narrative construction, dramatic action, which had never left her. She was said to walk the halls of MGM with screenplays held discreetly in folders so as to hide her involvement. And in the 1940s, her work went entirely uncredited on screen, and there were times when even Marion began to regret choosing the anonymous life of a screenwriter. In 1943, she signed back on with MGM at $750 a week and with the job title Editorial Assistant to Louis B. Mayer. This was on a trial period. She stayed and her salary rose, but she was effectively an advisor, kept on staff only so that another studio did not benefit from her services. Marion retired from Hollywood screenwriting entirely in 1946 to devote herself to writing plays and novels. And she said quite self-effacingly that there were limits to what she could achieve on screen. You have four or five notes, and then when those are used, you have the same four or five notes all over again. But in truth, she had also been rather scarred by the movie business and how it had seemed to turn on her. She now viewed the MGM lion not as a kitten, but as a cat who destroyed its own. And yet anyone who looks at Marion's films will know that she always seemed capable of finding more notes. And the phenomenal loyalty she inspired in the colleagues who really stuck by her is testament to the work she did. As well as those 300 or more screenplays and all the films, Marion wrote books. And two of them are particularly of interest if you have questions you want to answer about her career and her time in silent Hollywood. In 1972, she wrote a remarkable book, a memoir called Off With Their Heads, A Serio-Comic Tale of Hollywood, which is as frank and funny as you'd expect, if not too forthcoming about personal details. And this is a great way to learn about the truth about silent filmmaking. But actually, she had already written such an expose in 1924. I couldn't find the original cover for this book, Minnie Flynn. She wrote it in 1924. This is the re-release cover. The eponymous heroine is a shop girl who lives in a New York tenement, who's discovered by a sleazy actor and eventually becomes a very famous film star called June Day. In this novel, Marion really tears apart the gossip, pretensions, and desperation of studio folk, as well as offering her own, of course, insider's perspective on silent cinema. She called the novel a tragedy of success. And she said that it would act as a warning to young girls everywhere who dreamed of making it in the movies. I call it propaganda, said Marion, but the publishers call it a novel. The predatory producers, financial risks, and emotional toll of the music business are all laid bare in this gripping and very candid. Minnie Flynn's path to the top of Hollywood is not easy, but it's really the way down that hurts, the disillusionment of her inevitable decline. As one of the novel's few morally upright characters says, Hollywood is a little narrow house, Minnie, and some of us have made of it a cell. I think that Hollywood did become a little bit smaller for Marion as she progressed through her career, and that's a really sad thing. The day before Marion died, however, in 1973, she called a friend and she told her, my life has been full and wonderful and I wouldn't have changed it for anything. Her own story was indeed about to end. She died of an aneurysm, aged 84. Frances Marion's legacy is vast. We have all these films, so many of which are such a delight. And also, we have a sort of wider legacy. She really invented our idea of what a Hollywood screenwriter is or could be. In fact, in 1937, she wrote one of the first successful manuals in this field called How to Write and Sell Film Stories. But her skill was a little bit less tangible than that. She wrote stories that stars wanted to embody and that audiences wanted to be immersed in. And because she was so successful with her manipulation of narrative and sentiment, she was able to smuggle something more interesting, perhaps a bit more subversive, into her films as well. She found a way to tell stories of female strength when such things were questioned, and to explore the lives of marginalized people, all the while creating spectacles of pure excitement and remarkable tenderness on the big screen. The history of Hollywood would look very differently about Marion, so anyone's attempts to forget her vital contribution are incredibly misguided. She was indeed one of its finest and most thrilling storytellers, whose films always had that pulse of real life that she sought off the screen as well as on it. Thank you so much for listening, and I hope you enjoy many Frances Marion films.
Thank you so much, Pamela. That was absolutely wonderful. What a wonderful insight into the woman behind the work and how involved she was in so many stages of production. And so much to enjoy. I really loved that story that you shared about how she described Hollywood by comparing it to the Oscar statuette. And just great to hear about the roster of stars that she helped to shine, and what a legacy of work for us to enjoy. Also, just thank you as well so much for the stills and the clips with Mike's music. Brilliant. Thank you so much. And the stills that you found to share with us, so many beautiful ones, and love that beautiful shot of Marion and Pickford working together. You just, that still image said so much and backed up so well what you were saying. And just overall, just an excellent way of help your presentation. Thank you, Pamela. Just an excellent way of helping right the wrong that done to her by failing to credit her adequately. And just lots of tantalizing tips for our future viewing and reading choices. And finally, thanks to all of you at home for joining us. This conversation will remain on the Falkirk Leisure and Culture YouTube channel, in our Hip First at Home playlist, where you can rewatch at your leisure. Tell your friends. And I hope you will join us again soon for our next Hip First at Home presentation. See you soon.